In this video, we are going to have a look at all the kind of different connections of decoupling capacitors. And we are not going to only compare these connections, so we are not only going to find out which one is better and which one is worse, but we are going to also have a look how much better and how much worse these connections are when you compare them together. Like, what do you think, how much better or how much worse is this connection comparing to this one which is here? Do you know? When you go on internet, you can find many different pictures like this, and there are articles explaining that when you are connecting decoupling capacitors, you should use like really, really good connections. For example, something like this, or maybe even better, something like this. But in reality, when I'm designing boards, very often there is no space. And very often, for example, I have to connect decoupling capacitors like this. So does it mean I'm doing my layout wrong because I'm not using this kind of connection? And that's what I wanted to know. I wanted to know how much worse is this connection comparing to this one. So I created a number of boards. I actually created like three big PCBs with a number of small boards, and on every single small board there is one or a number of different decoupling capacitors placed and connected different ways. And I simulated all these boards. I measured the PDN impedance for every connection on these small boards, and I pick up the most interesting connections, and that's exactly what you can see here on this picture. In the background, you can see PDN impedance graph for all these pictures which are here. And in this video, we will try to find out which of these lines belongs to which of these pictures. You will try to find out, I know, because I simulated. I'm really curious if you will guess correctly. For example, what do you think? Which of these connections is the worst one? Which picture belongs to this line which is here with highest impedance? Or which of these connections is the best one? Yeah, these lines which are down here with lowest impedance. What do you think? Which pictures belongs to these lines? And that's what we will speak about in this video. My name is Robert Feranek, I'm from FEDEVEL Academy, and let's have some fun. I really hope you will find this video useful and interesting. Here it is. First, let's speak about the boards. Very quickly, I use JLC PCB for layer stackup. When we go and when we have a look at the board, you will see on top layer there are mostly the capacitors. On the layer 2, there are usually ground planes, except this example which is here. In this example, half is ground plane and half is power plane. On layer 3, again, mostly power planes, except this example. Here is half is power plane and half is ground plane. And on the bottom layer, there is usually nothing except this two examples. The schematic is very simple, just full of capacitors. What is important, there are these input and output connectors which I used for the simulation. If you have a look on the board, you can see the input connector is always here on the left and the output connector is always on the right, and they are always placed at the same position for every single small board. When we go into simulation, Then here you can very nicely see that I used, or I set all the input connectors as the power supply, and I set all the output connectors as the sinks. So these are the connectors which will sink the currents. For the capacitors, I just use standard model from database. And for the simulation settings, I just use something really simple, nothing complicated. Once everything is set up, you can just run these simulations. And what we can see here, these are the PD and impedance results. If you don't know what this PD and impedance means, don't worry. Only what you need to know is that when this line is higher, the connection to our decoupling capacitors is worse. When this line is lower, then the connection to our decoupling capacitors is better. Okay, when we have a look at our picture, the line which is here, this is worse, and the line which is here, it's better. If you would like to know more about PD and impedance, then have a look at these my videos about PCB layout and decoupling. And before I started creating these videos, I had no idea what PD and impedance means. And after you watch these videos, you will understand why it is important. Especially have a look at this measure and fix video, where we will be fixing this peak, which is around 2 ohms, and you will see how much noise this peak around 2 ohms can generate on your board. And when we have a look at this picture, where you can see the impedance of different connections to our capacitors, you can see the impedance for this 100 megahertz can be between 0 and 3 ohms. So even this looks like very small numbers, they still can be very important for your connections on your PCB. And when you go into higher frequencies, so this is 100 megahertz here, if you go into higher frequencies, you can see the impedance of these connections to our decoupling capacitors, the impedance can go even higher, like about 10 ohms here. And that's like really, really bad. 100 ohms here. That's like very bad connection. So this is something what you need to understand. The impedance what we are going to talk about is, or it looks like quite small, but it is still important, especially for higher frequencies, you will see much and much bigger impact of these connections, what we are going to talk about. So when we will be doing these simulations, you can look at these small boards as a connection between power supply and power pins with decoupling capacitor. Okay, so this input connector, you can always imagine this as power supply on your board. And this output connector, which is on the right, you can imagine this as power pins on your board. And this is the decoupling capacitor on your board, and this is the connection what we are going to, or what we are trying to find out how good this connection is. So in this specific example, you can see we placed vias close to each other and we connected the decoupling capacitor with white traces. In this other example, we have the power supply where? How you can imagine this board? The power supply is on the left, the power pins of your chip are here on the right, and we placed 100 nanofarad capacitors on the board, and we connected it with these very thin tracks, and we would like to know how good this connection is. Now, as I explained before, this is 4-layer PCB. Then on the layer 2, you can see there is the ground plane, and on layer 3, there is the power plane. So that's how these decoupling capacitors are basically connected to this power supply and to these power pins. In different example, we place the vias very close to the pads. Okay, again, layer 2 is ground plane, layer 3 is power plane. Power supply, you can imagine power supply on the left and power pins on the right. Different kind of connection. One 100 nanofarad capacitor connected with white traces. Okay, in different examples, I use all the kind of connections. In these examples, you can see also the power supply is connected through many vias, and the power pin has many vias which go into the ground plane and power plane, and they are connecting these decoupling capacitors. These are all the kinds of examples what we can see here in this picture. And only what is missing is to find out which of these lines belong to which of these pictures. And that's what we are going to do now. Let's start with something simple. And what do you think? Which of these lines is from this connection, what we can see here? I'm going to give you some time. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. It's this one. It's not the worst one. Now the question is, what do you think? Which of these connections is this line which is here? Which of these connections is the worst? You can guess. Are you ready? It's this one. When we have a look at the board, you can see that even this connection is using thin traces. It is still better than in this example, where we place wider traces, but the capacitor is further away from the power pins. And in this picture, you can very nicely see what is the difference between these kind of connections. Now, what do you think? How much better is this connection comparing to this one? What do you think which of these lines is from this connection? Something up here or something down here? Are you ready? Here it is. They are almost exactly the same. So there is not really big difference between this connection and this one. And what about these connections? When you read the articles, they will tell you placing vias on side of the capacitor is better than placing them this way. And here in this example, you can see the vias are placed close to each other. Here are a little bit further, but they are still connected with white traces. And in this case, the bigger vias and bigger holes are used. What do you think? How much difference is between all these examples which are here? I'm going to enable the arrows. There is no really big difference between these connections. And there is not much difference between these connections and this one which is here. So, yeah, it's not really like big deal. There is something much more important what we just learned. Do you know what is it? The placement may be much more important comparing to how exactly you connect the decoupling capacitor. When we place the decoupling capacitor further from the power pins, the connection is much, much worse than when we place the decoupling capacitor closer to the power pins. So the place where you put the decoupling capacitor can make much bigger difference than worry about what kind of tracks you use or where exactly you place the vias. And what was very surprising for me, many people, they keep saying it does not really matter where exactly you place the decoupling capacitor if you have power planes, ground plane and power planes in your board. But from this simulation, you can actually see that even we are using power planes, the place where you put the decoupling capacitor, it still makes huge difference. So it still makes sense to place the decoupling capacitors as close to the power pins as possible, because that will improve the connection, the quality of the connection. Very interesting. Now, the question is, how can we make this better? What can we make better? Using instead of one via per pin, use more vias. For example, two vias. Or you can place more capacitors and then use more vias to connect these capacitors. This also should improve the connection. Question is, how much better the connection will be when you use two vias per pin instead of one via? I'm going to enable the arrows. Have a look. This one and this one. So it does make difference. Not like huge impact, but it is still difference. And what about these connections? What is difference between this connection and this one which is here and this one which is here? In this connection, we place multiple vias only around the decoupling capacitor, but the power supply and the power pins, they still use only this one via. So what do you think? Is there difference when you use multiple vias only around the capacitor and if you use them also around the power pins and power supply? And how much difference it makes if you put there like many vias comparing to using two vias per pin? Have a look. Interesting. You can see using two vias per pin, including the power supply and power pin, it makes the connection much better than if you just use two vias on the capacitor, and also using the polygons, of course. And there is not really much difference when you use two vias or like many vias. Difference is only like this. But what you need to keep in mind is that when you are using multiple vias, you should use them also around the power supply and power pin, because just using the multiple vias around the decoupling capacitor is not going to help you much. You need to have good connection also in the power supply and the power pins. That's what makes the difference. Next, I'm going to enable all the arrows for these examples with multiple capacitors, and we are going to talk about them. There are a few things what I would like to point out or highlight in these examples. As you could probably expect, this is the worst one from all this what I just enabled, but it is still quite good. Even these capacitors, they are connected through these thin tracks. This situation is like much better than using only one capacitor. And this situation is very similar to this one. Yeah, difference is only this. And in this situation, we are placing the vias very close to the path. So this supposed to be like much better than this kind of connection. And here in this graph, you can see that it's not really big difference between these two situations. So interesting. And also this is interesting. In this example, I only use few vias, a couple of polygons, and I use the vias also on the power pins and the power supply pins. And you can see this is even better than these two examples which are here. This is down here comparing to this other. And it's using only few vias. Then I was just curious. I wanted to know if there is difference when I'm using 10 100 nanofarad capacitors comparing to using 10 nanofarad capacitors. And you can see there is not really difference. And then also I wanted to know if there is difference between placing the capacitors into two rows comparing to one row. But here are 10 decoupling capacitors and here are only 8 decoupling capacitors. In this example, they are all oriented same way. In this example, they are all oriented always the other way. So plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. There is not really much difference. And as you could expect, 8 decoupling capacitors is a little bit worse than using 10 decoupling capacitors. Even the placement is a little bit different. But this example down here is still using 8 decoupling capacitors, but it is better than these examples with 10 decoupling capacitors. Do you know what is different about this example down here? This is using multiple power planes and multiple ground planes. If we go into board, this is the example. So when I highlight the power, you can see on the top layer there are these polygons. On the layer 2 there is big power plane. On layer 3 there is also power plane, and on layer 4 there is also power plane. So three big power planes plus the polygons on the top, they are all connected in parallel. Same for ground. Okay, if I click or when I highlight the ground net, you can see on the top layer there are these big polygons, layer 2 big ground polygon, layer 3 ground polygon, layer 4 ground polygon. So again, multiple power planes are connected in parallel. And this is what makes the difference between this situation and this other. And it is actually the best connection when you compare all these other examples with multiple capacitors. Now, only what left are a couple of other examples, so let's have a look at these. This was something very surprising to me. Notice this example. I'm going to enable the arrow. What you think about this? Because this is something what I was not expecting. In this example, you can see the power supply is basically directly connected on top layer with the decoupling capacitor and with the power pins, and the results are like too good. I don't know what to think about this. That's why I'm really interested to know what you think. If the simulation is wrong, or simulation is not taking something into care, or it is actually correct, and this kind of connection, even if it's using thin traces, it is still better than, for example, this kind of decoupling capacitor placement. I really don't know what to think about this. But still, I'm going to enable the rest of these connections so you can see where are the graphs for these other examples. When you use wider tracks, the results are better. You can see it here, this one versus this one. When you use even wider polygons, again, result is a little bit better. Here is result with polygons, and this is the result with wider tracks. And when you use like very, very huge polygons on the top layers, then the results are not much better comparing to these polygons which are here. They are quite similar. And then I place also 8 capacitors on the top side, 8 capacitors on the bottom side, you can see the results are much better comparing to one capacitor, but it's not really important if they are on top layer or top side of the PCB, or if they are on the bottom, or if they are vias or not. The results are very similar for these two examples. If these last simulations, if they are correct, it would mean that direct connection to your decoupling capacitor is always much better than using decoupling capacitors through vias. It would mean that placing decoupling capacitor on same layer as your power pins and connecting decoupling capacitor with power pins on the same layer, this would be always like way better than actually connecting decoupling capacitors through vias. This is very interesting, because this would mean that if you place decoupling capacitors on bottom side of the chip, it's not like the best connection. You can always do it better if you place it on the same side as your chip. Wow! Maybe what I should do, I should maybe build this board and measure the real board and compare them with the results from this simulation, if what we can see here, if this is actually really true. And let me know, what do you think? Should we build this board and measure it? Leave comments. By the way, for everyone who is curious and who would like to know what would be the difference if we use capacitors with different size, with different footprints, I simulated these kind of situations and there was not like big difference. So that's the reason why I did not include different capacitor sizes in this video, because the results were very similar. Also, I simulated a couple of examples where I placed the components on the bottom side of the PCB. So for example, here you can see this kind of connection on the bottom, and it is exactly same connection here, but on top side of the PCB, there was no really difference. So I did not really spend much time trying to simulate boards with components on the top and also components on the bottom. Before we finish this video, I would like to say huge thank you to Steve Sandler from PicoTest. And he is helping me a lot. I had number of calls with Steve, and we discussed these simulations and the boards. He came up with some ideas what kind of connections we could try. And if you think we should also measure this board, then Steve would be the right person to help us with this, trying to find out which of these connections are really like the best. Okay, so I would like to thank you very much to Steve Sandler for big support when I was creating this video. Thank you, Steve. We are almost finished. I will post a link to this picture under this video. So if you like this picture, you can then simply just download it through the link, which you will find in the description of this video. And that's it. That's everything for today. If you have any ideas what kind of situation we could try to simulate, leave comments. What would you like to see? What kind of connection to decoupling capacitor you would like to see simulated? Okay, let me know. If you found something surprising in these results, leave comments. If you found this video interesting, guess. Leave comments. If you like this video, don't forget press like button. If you would like to see the future videos, you know what to do. Press subscribe. I would like to thank you very much for watching and see you next time. Bye.